Okay, well, welcome to ME3501L's experiment on the combined loading apparatus. And in this case, what we have is we have a hollow aluminum tube that is fixed to the support on this end. And on this end, it's got three locations where we load it up. Let me move the strain gauge conditioner out of your path so that you can see it. So it's got a central location over here, which is loaded dead center on the tube. And so any load that you put over here introduces only bending in the tube. And then we have these two lateral loading locations where the support on this side, the load on this side, and the load on this side are symmetrically located about the center of the cross section over here. So if you put the same load here and here, this one pulls up at the same amount that that one pulls down. So that's a couple, and it introduces a torque into the tube. So during this experiment, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be loading the central support as well as the side supports with the same amount of load. So I'll put a couple of pounds here, a couple of pounds here, a couple of pounds here. And then that introduces combined bending and torsion into the tube. And that's a complex state of stress, which you can analyze using your strength of materials calculations to find out what's going on at the base of the tube where it's supported over here. And then at very close to the base of the tube, what we have is we have a 3-gauge 45-0-45 rosette of strain gauges mounted, which are going to measure the strain in this direction, that direction, and in this direction. Okay, so as we load this thing up in combined tension and torsion, we'll experimentally obtain the values of strain at the location of the rosette. And then you'll use the dimensions for the tube. And the important dimensions are the distance from the center of the rosette to the point at which the load is being applied, not the end of the tube, but the point where the load is being applied to the center of the rosettes. So that length we're going to be giving you. And then obviously we're going to give you the distance from the supports over here so that you can figure out what torque is being applied from the distance from the loads over here to the center of the tube. And then we'll give you the cross-sectional dimensions of the tube, the diameter and the thickness of the tube. And you know that the material is made out of aluminum. And then from that, you can calculate the theoretical state of stress at the location of the rosette, and from the three-dimensional Hooke's law, you can convert between the 3D state of stress to the 3D state of strain, or vice versa. And so experimentally, you're going to be measuring the state of strain on the surface of the tube, and using Hooke's law, you could go back to the state of stress if you wanted to. So you can use your calculations of based on the bending moment and the torque and the measurements of the strain, and you those two come together at this location. And we're asking you to do a comparison between your experimental results and your theoretical results, and also to plot Moore's circle for the state of stress and strain there, and to see what you can observe. The way that we're going to measure the strain in each one of the three gauges in the strain gauge rosette is using this blue strain gauge conditioner box. Okay, so I'm going to turn the power on to this blue strain gauge conditioner. This is a different strain gauge conditioner than the one that we used for the cantilever beam. The cantilever beam one, you saw a lot of dials and knobs, and it only had one channel, and it did not compensate for the kind of bridge that you had. This blue strain gauge conditioner is much more state of the art. It's fully digital, so I'm going to turn this on over here. It has four channels, which is what we need since we have three different measurements that we want to make simultaneously. And it fully compensates for the type of bridge that you have automatically, so you don't have to manually divide by two or divide by 4 if you have a half bridge or a full bridge. So the first thing that we want to do is we want to set up the right number of channels. Right now, if you can see on the screen, channels 1 and 3 are active, channels 2 and 4 are blanked out. But I actually need 3 channels because I have 3 gauges in my rosette. So I'm going to push this button over here that says 1, 2, 3, 4 channel. This allows you to select whether the channels are active or not. And so I'm going to scroll down to channel 2 and make that one active as well. And then I push menu to pop back up. And now you can see channels 1, 2, and 3 are all active. Channel 4 is inactive. Next thing I want to do is I want to make sure that they all have the appropriate bridge configuration. So I push the button that says bridge on it. And you can see channels 2, 3, and 4 are set to quarter bridge. Quarter bridge is what we want. Channel 1, however, is set to half bridge adjacent. So I'm going to change the bridge configuration for channel 1 until it reads quarter bridge. Push menu to pop back up, and now they're all 3 set for quarter bridge. Next thing I want to do is I want to set the gauge factor. Again, the gauge factor depends on the package of strain gauges that you get. So this particular package of strain gauges had a gauge factor of 2.12. So I'm going to push the gauge factor 1 over here. You can see channel 1 has a gauge factor of 2.12. That's excellent. So what about channel 2 has gauge factor of 2.12 already? Channel 3 has a gauge factor of 2.12, but channel 4 has a gauge factor of 2.075. So if we were using channel 4, I would scroll down over here to this one and change the gauge factor for channel 4 until it reads 2.12. And then pop up, and then we're all set. So now all 3 of our channels that are active have the correct gauge factor on them. And so now all that's left is we have to follow the correct circuit diagram. This is the circuit diagram that we're going to be using. We're going to be using quarter bridge, channels 1, 2, and 3. And then remember, when you do a quarter bridge circuit, you have your active gauge that goes between P plus and S minus, and then from S minus you have to put a jumper over to the correct dummy resistor, which in this case, since our gauges have 120 ohm standard resistance, the correct dummy resistor is D120. So we're going to be using this circuit diagram, and on this side we're going to be going to D120. So I'm going to take the blue and green wires, which is for this strain gauge that's pointing 45 degrees in that direction. The orange and yellow are the ones for the strain gauge that is pointing straight down the axis. And the red and the brown ones are the ones that are pointing for the strain gauge that's pointing 45 degrees in the other direction. And I'm going to wire those to channels 1, 2, and 3. And then once that wiring has been done, then we are ready to load up the instrument and read the strain settings. So I'm going to go ahead and do that wiring, and then we'll come back. So this is, I'm just about to make the last connection over here. And again, make sure that when you're making these connections, you're clamping down onto the wire and not onto the plastic. That's the number one source of error in this lab. The one of the nice features about this strain gauge conditioner is that the connections are made. You remember on the yellow box, I had to unscrew things, slide this in. I couldn't see if it was in or not properly, and then tighten it down. And that makes you much more prone to making bad connections. On this particular strain conditioner, it's got these nice switches that you pull up over here. You insert the wire, and then you go down. And you can see whether you're on plastic or not, because if you leave a little bit of wire protruding, you know for sure you're not on plastic. And then you can tell whether or not you made a good connection by gently tugging on it. And if it doesn't move, then you've got a good connection. So this one, in addition to all of the other advantages it has, it makes mistakes in wiring the transducer much more rare. So here we are. We've connected all of our gauges over to the device, and what you can see is you've got some readings on there, right, which are non-zero. So I'm going to need to balance those readings out so that with zero load, all three of my gauges read zero. So I'm going to push this balance button over here that says automatic balance. And to balance it, I'm going to push balance again. And then it does an electronic balancing, and then it says, do you want to save that or not? Yes, I do. So I push record, setup saved, and now I should have zero readings on all of my gauges, which I more or less do. This one is reading plus 0.0002. This one is reading minus 0.00001. That's pretty close to balanced. You can try balancing it again, but it's pretty hard to get it any better than that. That's already very close. So let's just try one more time, and then if it doesn't get any better, then we'll call it a day. Okay, so 0, 0, and then 1 microstrain on that. Okay, so now I'm going to load the device up with 2 pounds on this side, 2 pounds on this side, and 2 pounds in the center. And then we take the readings off of each one of those strain channels, and that permits us to calculate both the bending and torsional strains through the strain gauge rosette calculations. Okay, so the rest of the experiment is we put 2 pounds in 2 pound increments, we go up to 6 pounds at each loading location, and then just take a look at it and see what you think. You might want to think about whether this makes sense to you, because right now, channel 1 is one of the 45 degree gauges, channel 3 is the other 45 degree gauge. And what you notice here is channel 1 is reading minus 17, channel 3 is reading plus 34. Does that make sense to you? If I had pure torsion, those two would have been completely symmetric, right? And in fact, if I remove the central 2 pound load, I better get symmetric readings on channels 1 and 3, which you see it almost is. Channel 1 is now minus 26, channel 2 is plus 25. So, but when you put the central load on there, you have bending as well as torsion. And so why is it that makes that reading asymmetric? See if that makes sense to you. And then when you do your strain gauge calculations, your rosette calculations, and then you do more circle, you'll see if the theory that you have for combined tension and torsion matches up with your experimental numbers. Good luck analyzing the test.